Thank you. taking me a little bit to get organized. I apologize. I want to welcome you all to the worship service of First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ in St. Albans. My name is the Reverend Jessica Moore, and I am joined this morning by Stephan, our organist and pianist, Stephan McLaughlin, who is our Facebook live streamer, and Sandy Christman, who will be our scripture reader this morning. First Congregational Church is an open and affirming church, and what that means is that no matter where you are, no matter who you are on life's journey, where you are welcome here to worship with us. We are an inclusive community. Please join us. Do we have any announcements this morning?
Insights to homelessness and what it means to the faith community. I hope you can come
It's from 7 to 9, Monday, October 4th, and a second presentation, October 5th, also 7 to 9 p.m. And just a quick reminder, because I know we all want to be there, October 10 is the organ recital, and Stephan will be playing his Mass. So we all, I know we all want to come out and hear it all together. I understand from Erin that we probably are familiar with little bits and pieces, but we've never heard it as a Mass. So I hope we can all will come and listen. Thank you. We have a couple of folks coming in and getting settled, so I'll do another announcement while they're doing that. On three Saturdays in October, from 10 to noon, we're having Walking the Walk. It's an adult education opportunity. We're going to look at everyday practices, both spiritual and psychological, that will help us live into Jesus' vision. So how to better love our neighbor, how to love our neighbor through conflict, how to live into forgiveness. I will be leading this with the Reverend Janet Brown, who's an Episcopal priest up at Grace Episcopal Church in Sheldon. It's really an exciting opportunity. I hope you will be able to join us. We still have a few spots. If you will join me in the spirit of prayer for this morning's call to worship. I am the church, you are the church.
We are the church together.
We depend on our seniors and long-term members to remember where we came from and where we have been.
We are the church together.
We depend on our children to retell our sacred stories as they grow.
We are the church together.
We depend on our youth and young adults to ask us why we do things this way and to suggest something new.
We are the church together.
We need each other to be the church.
We are the church together.
The opening hymn, if you want to follow along, is number 339 in the Pilgrim Hymnal, All My Hope on God is Founded. We are masking and we are not singing, but we can listen with appreciation. Gifts and the ways we may use them in community.
Suffering Savior, we confess that in our own struggle to survive, we have ignored other communities. We have forgotten that they too have the right to survive. Make us mindful, make us compassionate. Help us to see you in one another. Amen.
Through good days and through bad days, everything seems to change day to day. But there is one thing that remains constant, and that is God's love for you. God loves you without condition today, tomorrow, and every day. Amen. We'll now pass the blessing of the peace, hands free, saying the peace of God or the peace of Christ be with you, and responding also with you. We can do peace hands or elbow touches. Your choice. You can do both.
Hey, peace be with you. Always glad to hear you. Can't wait to hear the Mass on the 10th. Hi again, Joel. Nice to be with you.
Do you guys know what this thing is? It's a salt lamp. I'm feeling calmer already, which is a good thing. This was given to me, and you know, it's been really tempting to lick it, but I haven't. I haven't tasted it. But it's beautiful. I noticed that the humidity this summer has caused it to kind of seep a little bit, and so I have a little bit of repair to address it, but I didn't realize that it was leaking on. In today's reading, we have all sorts of discussion about salt. And I just have a question for you. What is a saltine without salt? It's teen, right? Nothing. What is a pretzel without salt? Nothing I've ever experienced. What about salted caramel without salt?
That's pretty good.
It's okay, but it's better with salt. Everything is better with salt, in my opinion. I'm a salty person. Not in that way. I love salt. And what's cool about salt is that it is just itself. You don't eat buckets of salt. You add it to food that's already there. It enhances the flavor. It gives it additional flavor of that little nice tang. And that is kind of like what we are inside. That's what Jesus is talking about in the day of the reading. He says, salt is good, have salt in yourself. And if salt isn't salty, what is it? So be yourself, because if you're not yourself, you're nothing. And when we share ourselves with the community, with each other, when we share the love and compassion of ourselves with others, we create something really tasty and wonderful. Here ends the lesson. Let us pray. Holy Creator, help us to season each other with the love and compassion of our deep selves and our deep love for you. Amen.
Amen.
John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop them, because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop them, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterwards to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." Here ends this morning's reading. May God have a blessing to our understanding of these words.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my strength and my redeemer. There's a lot in this morning's reading, a lot of layers, a lot of meanings. But I'm going to actually start with something I know about, which is seasonings. Some of you may know I spent most of my adult life running a small business, and I made spice blends. And I wrote recipes to support them, and I sold them in various ways, from having a full-blown brick-and-mortar store to moving online and traveling around with them. I had a lot of fun. I really like food. And I like to create theories about things, so I created a lot of theories about blending spices, what affects their flavor, how they're blended. For instance, when you grind oily spices together, say coffee and black pepper, it creates a depth of flavor that you can't get if you grind them separately and then mix them. And it didn't take long for me in this world of selling spices to realize that people have decided likes and dislikes. And most people fall into liking one of two categories, sweet and salty. I know if you're like me, you're probably thinking, well, people like spicy hot food, so that should be its own category. But it's really not, because people only like spicy hot when it's sweet or when it's salty. People just don't like straight chili peppers. You gotta do something. And as a general rule, we love salt as human beings. We use it not only to flavor our food, it's a flavor enhancer. It brings out the natural flavors already present in the food. It also preserves food. Think of old-fashioned New England salt cod. Or in my ethnic food tradition, we use salt to ferment vegetables and sauerkraut, pickles, hams. Salt is also used for cleansing and disinfecting. Growing up by the ocean, we would frequently soak our skinned knees and blistered feet in the cold, healing waters of the Atlantic. Salt, it's essential. And it's been being processed since about 6,000 BCE, before current era, or for those of us who are old-fashioned, before Christ. The word salary really comes from Latin, and it was the allowance that the Roman soldiers were given to buy salt. So it has this great quality and value in the ancient world and in our world. In this passage, I love the imagery of salt. It's salt or it's not. And we really can't unsalt, try as we might. I had an acquaintance who was cooking a meal for us, and he had over-salted the stew. So his solution was to take a lid, put it on top of the pot, and pour salt onto the lid. He said, "My grandmother told me if I do this, the salt will rise up from the stew to meet its compatriots, I guess, on top of the lid, and it will jump out and join the salt on the lid." I know, it's funny. I actually was waiting for it to happen. It didn't. Salt is undeniably itself. If it isn't salty, it isn't salt. And in today's reading, that's one of the things Jesus is talking about. We are salt. The essence of who we are is undeniable. If we're not ourselves, then we simply are not. And like salt, the essence of who we are is best shared with others, sprinkled around the community, enhancing the world around us, and hopefully not over-salting and ruining things. We see a little conflict over salt in the beginning of today's reading from Mark, the reading of which is super intense and disturbing and a bit shocking. The conflict comes when someone, is sharing his salt with the world by casting out demons in the name of Jesus, which is not a bad thing. But he's not part of the group. He's not one of the 12 disciples. So the disciples, you know, report back to Jesus and tell him about the man who had the nerve to cast out demons in Jesus' name and how they tried to stop him, but they couldn't. And Jesus' response is a little shocking, because his response needs to be a little shocking, because once again, the disciples really aren't quite getting it. To recap a little bit of what they're not getting. Last week, the disciples were arguing over who was the greatest, and Jesus told them, whoever wants to be first must be last and servant of all. Jesus then held up a child who, in those days, was the lowest of the low in society. He held up this child and said, whoever welcomes this child, whoever welcomes the vulnerable, the lowly, welcomes not only me, but welcomes God. It's really expansive. We learn that Jesus' teachings are not just for a chosen few. They're for everyone, especially the lowly, and we're all welcome. It puts me in mind of the United Church of Christ tagline, no matter who you are and where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. It sounds so good. A quick little sentence that means so much. But who do we welcome? Everyone. How do we welcome? More difficult. What does that look like in action? Christian communities are not known for their inclusion. They have tended towards exclusivity. In middle-class white America, they have taken on the look of social clubs at times, reflecting a certain socioeconomic class, race, and gender roles. There's a tendency for humans to group together and become insular, reaping special benefits for the in-crowd. When I was running a Sunday school, I remember I was trying to get together a citywide youth group, because we had all these churches that had one or two kids. It wasn't enough to have a really good youth group in one church. So I thought, if we all get together, bring all the kids together, we'll have a good experience. And everybody thought it was a great idea, that everybody wanted it at their church. It was not something to be shared. It never happened. It was just a stumbling block we couldn't get over. So even the disciples, despite what Jesus had just been teaching them about accepting the lowest and opening up their arms, they still see themselves as separate and special, part of the select few. John said to him, teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. Really, John? Jesus seems to say. Jesus admonishes them, expanding the inclusive nature of his ministry yet again. Whoever is not against us is with us. And anyone, by just giving you a cup of water in my name, is on our side. Count on it. God will notice. So basically, anyone doing good work, anyone doing the work of Jesus, casting out demons, caring for others, is noticed by God, and as we might say, is on the side of the angels. Conversely, now Jesus is talking directly to the disciples, if you create a stumbling block, you prevent someone's faith from coming out, well, woe unto you. That is, if you try to deny someone else's salt, you're not honoring their humanness, and you're derailing them from their life's purpose, like trying to stop a man from casting out demons. After John tells Jesus about the man, Jesus moves into a really shocking metaphor. And it's especially shocking, I think, to our modern ears. Because as modern people, we're really used to hearing things as a fact or a fiction, or one or a zero of technology. And we are developing, I think, or at least I do, have a difficult time maneuvering in the realm of metaphor and myth and symbol. and they're tools that help us explore the depths of the human experience. And today's metaphor is particularly difficult because it's violent and self-inflicting nature. Jesus said it would be better for you to be drowned with a giant millstone around your neck than inhibit someone's faith, than to mock someone's faith. Further, if your hand or foot gets in the way, cut it off. Well, that's a rough teaching, especially coming from Jesus, who's known for his healing. It's shocking, and it's meant to be. It's a wake-up call. I'm put in mind of the old fire and brimstone preachers. You know, they have this intense, dire message, perhaps meant as a wake-up call, but certainly scaring people onto the right path. The shocking nature about what I've been calling in my head this week, the amputation passage, is in a way akin to what 12-step programs call taking care of your side of the street. Don't interfere with another person's faith or good works or salt. Pay attention to your own actions and stay on your own path. But be yourself. Let the Spirit fully inhabit your being. Embrace your salt. Share your saltiness, your humanness through love, which is the greatest seasoning of all. Amen. Our second hymn is We Would Be Building. It's in the Pilgrim Hymnal 494, if you'd like to follow along. Remarkable. Do we have other joys or any concerns that you would like the community to pray with you about this week?
Carol. This is a joy in regards to, in the same vein as Wayne being home, Doug and I were able to make our booster vaccination appointments for next week, so that we were really glad to be able to do that.
That's great. That is something to rejoice. So Doug and Carol were able to make their booster shot appointments for next week. Does that mean Florida is close?
Georgia's even closer.
Right. Sue?
For those of you that don't know or are of the age you don't, you certainly, I just want to say that I got mine yesterday, and you can walk into Christ Chopper without an appointment. That's one thing. And the other thing I want to say is you can get the drive through and they will set up an appointment for you, and just even driving through. And I got good information for people that are not aware of that. It's necessary.
Thank you. Yeah, so Sue is just saying that you can, Price Chopper, you can walk in without an appointment, and you got yours yesterday. And if you can also go through the King Drug drive through, and they'll help you with an appointment.
And get an appointment.
That's fantastic.
20 years ago, Doris, who was our organist, came out for us on the Conrady choir. And he just found out that now he's very important. He's a music therapist, and he got his job doing early intervention in music therapy. So our church follows us during the through the lifelong process. And because of Doris Hughes, because of what she did with our son, he's now following his dream. So I'd like
that's a joy. Diane was saying that Doris talked their son into joining the choir, and that got him on his path, and that it's just been part of their life together and his life now as he's on his proper path, would you say? Yes. Any other joys, concerns?
Well, with some great help, we now have firewood. Which and a nice thing for me to, you know, a piece of wood for me to split some of it on. So and this is church people from the church have helped with this. So that's great. Thank you.
For those of you who have been here, Stephan was just saying that we had help with firewood, kindling, and a chopping block. So we are really all set for this Vermont winter. Thank you. Any other joys or concerns? I have another joy, a dear friend of mine, Bill. He has heart condition. He was having heart pains, like chest pains this week. He ended up in the hospital. He got there before he had a heart attack. They were able to put a stent in, and we're really just so blessed that we didn't have to go through major surgery this week, and he's home resting and gardening, probably. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Gracious God, wonderful Creator, Holy One, we are so thankful for this opportunity to be together, seizing each other with love and compassion. O God of peace, help us to be reminded that you are always near. We come before you in prayer, lifting to you our joys and concerns, the hopes and dreams of our lives. May we also be open to your voice, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears. We ask you to hear our prayers for those who have touched us, for those who are in pain, who are ill, who grieve. May we touch their lives not only through our prayers, but through our lives and the sharing of our love and our actions. Guide us, bless us, uplift us, and hold us. For we are your children, called for your purpose in the world. Help us to reach out to you with love, and through your love to each other, nurturing, caring, and loving each other as you nurture, care, and love us. Help us to delight in you and each other. Amen. If you would all join me for the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our final hymn is Lord, Dismiss Us With Thy Blessing, number 63 in the hymnal. Extravagantly. Amen.